I tell you the truth, the man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he's brought out all of his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, I tell you the truth. I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Do you remember in the story of Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan, the 1700s? At one point, Pilgrim is making his way toward the celestial city after having fled from the city of destruction. And as he's going along, two fellows climb over the wall that protects the way in which he is walking. And he immediately begins to speak with them and ask them where they have come from. And they tell him that they are from a neighborhood close by. And he said to them, but you did not come in by way of the gate. You climbed over the wall, and the scriptures say that all who climb in any way other than by the gate are thieves and robbers. They blew him off. They did not want to hear that from him. And they went on their way, and soon they found a road leading away that seemed more comfortable, and they took that road because it looked more pleasant to travel. And Pilgrim never saw them again. They were lost. Now, I raise this story today because I have to ask you a very serious question. Did you come into this road, into this Christian walk, by climbing over the fence? Or did you come in by the gate? Now, don't answer that question very quickly. Think about it a moment. John Bunyan, in his story of Pilgrim's Progress, has Pilgrim say to these men, you did not come in by the gate, why not? And they said, because it would cause too much difficulty if we were to travel all the way back through the countryside and finally come in by way of the gate, we would just be losing time on our pilgrimage toward the celestial city. And Pilgrim's response was, I'm sorry, there is no way you can enter this way but by way of the gate. And then you also, because you came in over the wall, you did not come to the cross. You were never crucified. And so Bunyan is saying, look, you came in over the wall and you're willing to take on some of the appearance of a Christian traveler, but in fact, you're a thief, you're a robber. Now, what did he mean? He meant that you're coming and trying to steal from God some peace of mind. You're trying to steal from God some provision. You're trying to steal from God some friendship, some associates. But he's saying you're a thief, you're a robber, because you never went back to the beginning and were born again. And so here comes Mr. Pagan Man. He comes in over the wall because he has some religious leaning. He thinks that religion is important in one's life. And so he climbs over the wall, and now in his religious state, he would like to add to his already worldly life the benefit of some peace of mind, some benefit of fellowship with others who are on the way. Now, these men wanted to walk with Pilgrim, but because of his piercing questions, they fled from him. And they said, "We don't want to talk with this man. All he does is say things that are unpleasant to us." Now, I must ask you today, are you a thief and a robber? Have you climbed into the kingdom of God in some way that allowed you not to completely die to self? Have you climbed into the kingdom of God by saying some little sinner's prayer, being told that you're saved, and now you're on your road, you're on the way, but now you want prosperity, you want all of the benefits? And I'll be frank with you, many churches will promise you all of those benefits if you will just be a part of their fellowship. But you are still a thief. And in the spirit today, I know that many of you who are listening to this broadcast are thieves and robbers. You did not come into Jesus Christ by the gate and through the crucifixion. You climbed over the wall. You saw something that you thought you would enjoy. You would enjoy the music. You would enjoy the fellowship. You would enjoy the religious sense and instruction. But in the deepest part of your heart, you know you are still a pagan person. Your heart is filled with anger or unbelief. You walk in sin. No Christian will walk in sin. You simply will not do that. Because you died, you were crucified, you were raised again with Jesus Christ. But let me not tell you that. Instead, let me share that with you directly from the Scriptures. Let's go today to the book of Romans, the 6th chapter. Let me begin with verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? So Paul is now going to address people who have heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. They have been made righteous. They have been justified. They have been born again. And he now speaks to those people. And he says, so now that you've been born again, shall we go on sinning? Now, one of the hermeneutical principles that I've learned through the years in the study of Scripture is that it's helpful if we pretty much take Scripture at face value and understand it in the simplest form possible. So when it says here, shall we go on sinning? I literally take it to mean that all sinning in the life of a Christian is now being called into question by the Apostle Paul. Let me read verse 2. He says, by no means, or absolutely not. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? If you have not died to sin, and you are calling yourself a Christian, Jesus calls you a thief because you're trying to steal salvation. You're trying to steal fellowship. You're trying to steal the benefits of following Jesus Christ without having entered through the gate and without having gone to the cross. Now he goes more in depth. verse 3. Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? In other words, when you come to Jesus Christ, you don't have a pronouncement made over you that says, now you're saved and everything is fine, and you continue to live with simply an improved life. No, that is what a thief does who steals some benefit. He steals that little bit of peace and joy, but his behavior remains the same on the inside. There is no way for you to be justified without you dying. Now, what do I mean by you dying? I'd like to be very explicit in what I'm saying to you so that there is no possibility of any misunderstanding. And please, I'm not trying to be difficult with you. I simply want you to understand what it means to come to Jesus Christ and what the cost is to be a real Christian. So what does it mean to die? Well, what does it mean to die in the physical body? Have you been with someone when they passed on, when they died? I've been with many people as they have died. I've held their hands. I've held them in my arms. I've talked and prayed with them. I've listened to their final confession of Jesus Christ or their confession of sin. What happens when a person dies? There is some painful time for most. If it's a heart attack, there is a painful clutching of the heart. For some, there is simply a painful time of sickness and then a drifting away until they take their last breath as they lose consciousness, and then they're gone. And all that remains on the bed is a shell of a body. But you can immediately tell that that person is no longer present. Well, when a person comes to Jesus Christ and he is crucified with Christ, there is a time of great pain. There is no coming to Jesus Christ without this great pain. If you suffered no pain, you have not come to Jesus. There will be suffering. That's as Jesus lights a fire under you, and this word to be justified from the Greek dikaiosune, meaning to render. There is a fire put under you, and that fire begins to expose to your heart the wickedness of your life. And the painful part is when you renounce that wickedness. You confess it without any reservation. You confess it before God and sometimes before man. You make no excuses. You admit that this is who you are and what you have done. You admit that this is the very nature of your soul, to be utterly lustful, corrupt. You don't hold back. You become brutally honest with yourself. If you have been promiscuous and you've been sexually unclean, you openly confess that to Jesus Christ and you say, this is who I have been. And this is what I have done. You confess it honestly and openly, and you renounce it, and you give it to Jesus, and you die to it. meaning it finally loses all of its breath in your soul, so that your heart can be filled with something other than anger. It can now be filled with the love of Jesus Christ. Now, some people have said to me, Pastor, my heart is always filled with lustful thoughts. Well, you don't have to let those lustful thoughts build a nest in your heart and produce offspring. But by a very quick renunciation of it, you give it to Jesus Christ. Some of these inner issues are taken care of in what we call sanctification. Sanctification is not ever to deal with sin. It's to deal with the inner character in what it wants to rise up and do, but by the power of the blood of Jesus, it's knocked down and it no longer holds dominion over you. The issue is justification, and some of you who have lustful thoughts always rising in your heart, it's because the work of dying has not been completed in your heart. And you're going to have to go back. And you're going to have to die to that thing. That's why the old timers called it praying through. Well, what did they mean? They meant praying through the lust, praying through the anger, praying through the unbelief, until the unbelief is put under the dominion of Jesus Christ, until it no longer has the power to rise up and sweep you away in that sin. And so when we find ourselves being swept away by sin, it's because there is a deeper death that must take place in our hearts. Now, we find this most especially when we grow discouraged. Discouragement comes because we have not been able to have our way. Discouragement comes because our self-life is still strong and beating in us. The antidote to discouragement is hopefulness. Hopefulness as we turn to Jesus with hands lifted up and say to Jesus, I recognize that I'm now being tempted to be discouraged because discouragement is a sin. Discouragement is a sin. Sorrow is not a sin. I want you to understand the difference. Grieving is not a sin. Sorrow is not a sin. Discouragement is hopelessness because I can't have my way. Now, why discouragement is so important to look at is because when we grow discouraged and we allow that to fester in our heart, we will turn then to the self-life to find some sop of comfort. And this is when many people will turn to the refrigerator, to that big bowl of ice cream. They'll turn to the pornography. They'll turn to some kind of uncleanness. They'll turn to a friend and play victim. All of these things are sin before God. The self-life has to die. Now, I'll be honest with you. The mortification of the soul is the painfulness of the death I am speaking of. You see, there's only one way that the self-life will die, and that is through the mortification of the soul. It's mortifying to confess honestly my condition before God, and if necessary, before my brother or my sister. That's mortifying. It brings shame. It brings sorrow. To mortify the soul is to uncover the soul. And we fight with all of our will to never be mortified, to never be embarrassed, to always look like we have it together, to look like we're right, to look like we know what we're doing. But to die means that I must be mortified. I must literally put to death this self-life. And I do that by bringing it out into the light where it can be seen. That's why Jesus said, those who love darkness don't come into the light because they don't want what they're doing to be seen. But a person who loves Jesus is going to come out into the light where everything about them can be viewed openly. It can be seen. You see, light kills the germs. Light kills the sin. It is the mortification of the soul that brings about the actual death of the old nature. So as we come to Jesus, Paul is saying, you were baptized into his death. In other words, in order to be baptized, you must repent. And you must renounce all filthiness of soul and spirit. That's why you're lowered under the water, symbolic of a body being buried in the graveyard. And then you're raised up out of that water in the newness of life, in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So for every person who is saved, who is not a thief or a robber, there is a very conscious process of dying and of being resurrected. A woman once said to me, Pastor, I've always been a Christian. I don't remember ever being born again. I guess I've just always been born again. I had to say to her, I'm sorry, ma'am. You're a pagan with a Christian faith spray painted on you real heavy. But in your heart, you still have a very strong self-life. You've simply chosen to express that in the Christian church. You are an extremely dangerous, dangerous person to the body of Christ because you have never come to terms with the inner wickedness of your soul. For Paul tells us in Romans, the first chapter, and then on into the third chapter, that all have sinned and all have fallen short of the glory of God. There is none who seeks after him. And so if you have always been a Christian, you have never been a Christian. There must come that place where we finally must deal honestly with who we are at the very essence of our spirit, at the greed, at the idolatry, at the desire for supremacy, the uncleanness of our spirit. These things must be looked at honestly, and they must be dealt with. This is what is meant in Scripture by dying. It is literally being baptized into the death of Jesus Christ. It is being crucified with Christ. Now I'm going to keep my hand right there in the sixth chapter of Romans, and we're going to come back to it. But I need to read to you this very famous passage of Scripture in Galatians, the second chapter. Paul says in verse 20, I have been crucified with Christ. Now, that does not come without pain. And the pain is the discovery of who we really are. Now, you can avoid this pain if you climb over the wall into the church by some way other than the gate of Jesus Christ and the cross of Jesus Christ. And you can appear to everyone to be a fine, upstanding Christian. You can even become a pastor. I have met many pastors who climbed in over the wall as thieves and robbers. And they frankly look at the church as a business, and they are there to prosper, and they're there to help their people prosper and to make money. They call the pastor's wife the first lady. He is the CEO. He is the boss man. They climbed in by another way. They did not come by way of the cross. They did not come by way of the gate. And the church is a prosperity machine. It's there to create a lifestyle of wealth. I've met others who are simply there for the pleasant rituals. If some aspect of the rituals are taken away, they feel like they have not been to church, because church for them is the church calendar. It is all of the ritual of the church, and they greatly enjoy all of that, and that is the sum and substance of their life. When they go out of the church, they walk like pagan men. They're angry, they're bitter, they love the professional sports, they seek to improve themselves as any worldly person would, taking seminars and workshops and trying to tweak the flesh. But in reality, they are thieves and robbers. They have never gone to the cross, and they've never died. Now, I'd like to open up the phone line today. I wasn't going to, but I'm sensing I'm to do that. Some of you, even as I speak to you, know that you're a thief. You know that you're a robber. If you'd like to talk about that, you'd like me to pray with you, that you could go to the cross, I'd be happy to do that. The only reason I come and do this broadcast is to help you on the journey. But if you crawled over the wall, you're going to have to go back. You're going to have to die. If you'd like to address this issue in your life, I invite you to call right now, 877-534-0780. I'll give you that number one more time, and then I'm going to move on. If you want to take advantage of this opportunity for me to pray with you, to ask questions, or to be honest about who you are, that you are a thief and a robber, that you still walk in sin, even though you call yourself a Christian, because you've never died, then call right now, 877-534-0780. I don't come here to pat you on the head and say, there, you're going to be saved. No, I come here instead to talk about the straight gospel of Jesus Christ. I know it's not popular today. I know it's not taught in very many churches today. But I can't do anything but teach this gospel, because it is my life. It is my everything. So Paul says, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. In other words, his self-life was put to death. But Christ lives in me. Can you say that's true of your life? If you can't, quickly call now. I would love to talk with you and pray with you. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. If righteousness can be gained by stealing it, if righteousness can be gained by being a thief in the house of the Lord, by going to workshops and seminars and learning more theology, if you can steal justification that way, then Christ died for nothing. Thieves will not enter into the kingdom of God. Are you a thief today? Be honest. I mean, I'm talking to you. You know what your life is like. Are you a thief? Are you trying to get into heaven by climbing over the wall and not coming in by way of the crucifixion and the death? Have you been made righteous? Or are you still walking in your sin? It's not adequate for you to say, I'm doing my best, Pastor. I have never yet done a funeral for a person who sits up in their casket and says, I'm doing my best to die, Pastor. It's never happened. When a person dies, they're dead. And then they must go through a resurrection. Isn't that the very hope of the Christian faith? If you have not died to your sin, you will not be in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You must come to terms with your sin. Mister, there's no way around this. You cannot continue to cheat, to lie, to steal, to fornicate, to commit adultery. You cannot continue to be what you call a loving person who walks in immorality before God and idolatry before God and even begin to think that you can go to heaven. You are a thief if you think this. You cannot steal the kingdom of God. It is not available for you to steal. There is only one way to enter the kingdom of God. And that is by every aspect of my heart being given over into the hand of Jesus Christ. There is no other way. Now let me continue in Romans, the 6th chapter, verse 3. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. What I'm offering you today is the opportunity to have a new life. But first, there must be the total and complete death of self. The self-life has to go. Notice, if we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with. The actual Greek word is absolutely be destroyed, be annihilated. So he's saying, for we know that our old self was crucified with Jesus, so that the body of sin could be annihilated. You see what I mean? And this is not the only place If you'll be honest in the reading of Scripture, nowhere does it teach that a man or a woman can continue to walk in their sin and have an expectation of being saved. There is a new work of justification that must be done in your life. And if you have believed and drunk the Kool-Aid that says that to be justified means to be declared righteous, you are saying that the blood of Jesus Christ is no more powerful than the blood of a bull or a goat. I want to tell you today, the blood of Jesus is not like the blood of a lamb or a bull or a goat. That was under the old covenant ceremonial system. In the new covenant, the blood of Jesus is almighty and all-powerful, and there is a depth that we are called to go to in the mortification of the self, in the dying to ourselves, that no self-life remains, that at every moment, in everything I do, in everything I say, love should be pouring forth from my heart. Compassion should be the natural response of my heart, not anger, not lust, not bitterness, but compassion poured out, overflowing, full of mercy. Is that your heart? If not, then you need to be justified. You need to be rendered innocent before God. And again, it's not a mechanical process. It is a process that is done by grace and by faith. And again, let's define our term faith. It means to put total confidence in. Let me put it this way. When I was a young man, I lived out in the country, right on the Shenango River. And the Shenango River was a deep and wide, slow-moving stream, muddy water. And when we were kids, we would go down to the river, and we would jump off the bridge over the river. It was an old-fashioned iron bridge with heavy planks across it in two huge sections. And my brother Roger and my brother Don would jump off into that water. But I was afraid to jump because I could look down over the edge and I could see the jagged rocks in one place. But then there was a deep channel that would go down under that water, under that bridge. And my brother Roger, my brother Don, both of whom were older than I was, would swim out to where that deep channel was. And it was slow moving. And they would have me position myself on the bridge so that I could jump directly into that deep water. Now, it was frightening on one side because I knew there were jagged rocks out there. On the other hand, the bridge was probably 20 feet above the water. It may have been a little further than that. I don't remember. We never measured it, but I knew it was a long ways up. And so I would stand there on the railing of that bridge, making sure that no cars were coming. And I would sway on that bridge, trying to get up my courage to finally jump. And Roger and Don, both down in the water, would be calling, "Come on, Ray, jump, jump, jump." Well, the only way I finally would have the courage to jump would be that I would put my total confidence in my brothers, Roger and Don. And when my total confidence was in them, that they were in that deep place in the water, I would finally hold my nose, shut my eyes, and jump out as far as I could jump. And then it seemed like an eternity until I smacked that water underneath. Faith means putting total confidence, putting everything on the line, and jumping. Now, we don't blind jump. We don't blind jump. We don't blind jump. We jump at the voice that calls us to jump. And the scriptures are the voice that give us all the information necessary to finally say, I am going to trust my life with my Savior, Jesus Christ. And I'm going to be crucified. I am going to let my self-life die. I am going to renounce it, and I'm going to ask Jesus to remove it from me. And when we take that action, we have put our faith in Jesus Christ. Now notice this. I'm going to read again verse 6 and continue into verse 7. For we know that our old self was crucified with him. That's that painful jump. And it takes time. So that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. There you have it. It's not from Pastor Ray. It's not from somebody who's over the top. It's the Apostle Paul. And he says that anyone who has died has been freed from sin and no longer walks in it. So, if you walk in sin today, it's because there is a lack of faith in Jesus Christ. That the self-life is still alive, and you are making a man in your life, or a woman in your life, or a career in your life, or your family, or your enjoyment, or your pleasure, whether it be the Redskins or something else, you are making something else your God and not Jesus Christ. Now please, if Jesus Christ lives in you, I will guarantee you he will not enjoy football. The angels are not going to organize a football league in heaven. It's just not going to happen. If you still enjoy the wicked things of this world, the ungodly things of this world, if you still enjoy going to the club and drinking and partying, if you enjoy going to the lounge and drinking and partying and giving foolish, dirty jokes, if you're still swearing and taking the name of the Lord in vain, if your heart is still rising up in lust that gives way to wickedness, if you're living with someone you're not married to, if you're fornicating, if you're having sex with someone you're not married to, then you still live in your self-life, and you are not in Jesus Christ. And in that condition, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. You cannot be saved. And your case is hopeless until you make a decision to face very honestly your condition, and you go all the way back to the beginning of the highway, because you are still in the city of destruction, even though you may be walking in what you call a Christian church. You have to go back, and you have to be allowed entrance at the gate at Jesus. You have to go to the cross. You have to be crucified. You have to give up your self-life. If you are unwilling to do this, then you cannot be saved. It's that simple. Am I preaching fire and brimstone? No, I'm not yelling or shouting at you. I'm speaking very calmly the truth of God. Now, I believe that our time is very short. I believe that within the next month to 2 months to 3 months, we are going to see dramatic things happen in this nation that will forever change our perspective on reality. I believe we're going to see some natural events that are going to transpire that will be terrifying to your heart. Remember this message when those things happen. You do not have much time left. In fact, you could die in what is about to happen in this world. Are you ready to die physically and be cast into hell? Or are you willing to take that self-life to the cross of Jesus Christ and lay down your life and be born again and be justified, be restored through regeneration to that place with God that flows with love and joy and peace and long-suffering? I plead with you today in the Spirit. I know that many of you listening to this broadcast today are still walking in sin. Some of you have never professed to be a Christian. Would you profess today? Would you say, Jesus, put me on the fire. Render me, cook me. Let me see my sin. I renounce it in the name of Jesus. Would you ask to be born again? Would you ask Jesus now to do whatever he has to do in your life to bring about the new birth in your life in order that you might be made into a new creature, that you might be brought into the fullness of Jesus Christ and enjoy the wonderful peace and joy of Jesus Christ living in you? Christ in you, the hope of glory. I know as I am in this radio studio, the Spirit of God is saying to me that there are also many of you who are thieves and robbers. You've entered into the Christian church by way of some wall that you've climbed over, but you've never died. You've been a Christian, you've said, for 20 or 30 or 40 years, but you've never died. You enjoy the fellowship, you enjoy the music, you enjoy the show, you enjoy the rituals of the church, but your heart is still filled with darkness. You're not really a follower of Jesus Christ, you're a follower of religion. I challenge you. Go back to the beginning. Start over. Enter through the gate. Stop being a thief. Christ will meet you. Jesus will meet you. And ask if he would crucify you. Deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow Jesus. He'll take you straight to Golgotha, where he'll put you to death. Are you willing to die with Jesus Christ today? He's very plain. He says, if we've been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be utterly destroyed, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. But what about those of you who believe you're going to live with Christ, but you've never died to sin? If you don't quickly come to your senses, you're going to face a very rude awakening very soon. Because as Jesus comes in the clouds of glory, you're going to face eternal damnation because you're a thief and a robber. Oh, a pretty thief, a handsome thief, but a thief. Because you never died to yourself. You never mortified the flesh. You were never willing to take the risk of truly admitting who you are on the inside. You go one place and they think you're one kind of person. You go somewhere else and they think you're a different kind of person. As one man said to me, I know how to hang out with the world, and I know how to hang out with the church. So with the world, he talks one way, and with the church, he talks another way. What tragedy when many times these kinds of people are placed in eldership or ministers or deacons, placed on the vestry board or placed in some role of responsibility, and even worse, when they're placed in the pulpit and they've never died. Today, will you receive Jesus Christ in the way necessary for him to receive you? Oh, Lord Jesus, I'm pleading for the many who I know are listening to this broadcast, but who are trying to find out if they have the courage to stop being a thief and a robber, or if they have the courage to confess their sin and admit their condition before you and be born again and be justified and be freed from their sin. Lord Jesus, have your way today, mighty God of heaven. I pray in your holy name. Amen. I'm Ray Greenlee, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. Go to nationalprayerchapel.com. You will find directions for the National Prayer Chapel. I welcome you. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present.